it was completely disingenuous for opposition to suggest that a war on drugs has been fast, that a war on drugs has been short. Ever since the war on drugs was initiated in 2001, the global supply of drugs has increased by 23%. Drug cartels have increased their profits by $120 billion ever since 2002, which is why on the side of proposition, we argue it's foolish to use limited state funds in a way that only harms existing drug users and the rest of society. I'm going to ask two points of contention for today. First of all, do we help existing drug users and protect the rest of society? Secondly, on this idea of choice, first point of contention on harm. What they told us in their first speaker was that a black market will inevitably still exist. We never claimed for a solution to be a panacea. So the real question is this, on which side do we allow the black market to be diminished? And it's our side. For the reason my first speaker gave you, which they haven't rebutted. When you have a legal mechanism which is far safer and far cheaper, people have no incentive to turn to a black market somewhere down a dirty alley where you're likely to get poisoned if you inject yourself with shards of glass in that drug concoction. So therefore, people are far less likely to turn to the black market. This also means that the supply of existing black market drugs will also reduce because suppliers are responsive to demand. So if the demand is lowered, correspondingly, the supply of more addictive drugs will also be reduced. When they talked about how black markets will provide more addictive drugs, our answer is simple. We'll legalize that as well, so the black market for that will not exist. Next, they ran an entirely fallacious argument about how now more people will take drugs. Let's be clear. The reason why the vast majority of people don't take drugs in the status quo is because that's simply not part of their lifestyle or because they recognize the potential health risks. It's not because the state bans it and all of us are somehow mindless fools who succumb to the will of the state. Therefore, our question is this. If we legalize smoking, as is done in the status quo, we don't see everyone rushing to grab cigarettes. So clearly, just because we legalize drugs doesn't mean that more people will take drugs. Next, they told us that drugs are incredibly addictive. People are going to sell everything they have and end up homeless. First of all, this neglects the very spectrum of drugs we set out in our first speaker. There's a spectrum of soft drugs, which they never tackle. So for that instance of soft drugs, where you preserve a huge majority of a choice, where you aren't tied to that drug for life, they never told us why it's not okay to legalize those drugs. But okay, even for harder drugs, for instance, if you argue they're so addictive, the real question is, if they're so addictive, people are going to take them anyway. At least on our side, you incentivize them to turn to existing state channels and rehabilitation centers, which can only exist when you use your funds to channel towards those rehabilitation centers and not to fight a losing war on terror. Finally, they told us that they're taxing people by this third-party hub. We think that the long-term costs of our policy are going to be far diminished because you don't need to treat people for the long-term cost when they turn to black market sources of drugs. So on that case, we better spend taxpayers' money. But next, we're going to argue that people are going to take drugs in our case which cause less third-party harm. Because in the status quo, if people turn to the black market, those are sources which perpetuate gang violence and crime. So there's massive third-party harm. On our side, when people turn to safe and legal state channels, all of these means that only people take drugs themselves, you will free them of the massive third party and societal harms which they so wanted to talk about. But they never rebutted my first speaker's analysis about funding drug gangs and giving them military technologies that even states and governments don't have. But next, they ran a case of fear-mongering about unemployment and illiteracy. Our question is simple. All of these are generic. So would you then ban alcohol, which is the second leading cause of death in the United States? They simply haven't justified their case on principle grounds. Next, on this idea of choice, they told us that but it's a social context as to whether or not you make a choice. We argue that your social context affects your choices all the time. Whether or not I take fast food is incentivized and conditioned by whether I live in the United States, where fast food is everywhere, for instance. So that's not a valid argument at all. But it never touched my first speaker's analysis about how future choice cannot objectively be said to trump your present choice. So there's no objective metric on which you can make this decision to ban drugs. So that's the first speaker's material dealt with. Next, I'll be moving on to my substantive, which will further clash with the material she brought up. And my substantive is about how we better protect existing drug users. The thesis of my argument is that we lower and reduce stigmatization of existing drug users, thereby protecting and safeguarding their health. Premise of this argument, that there will inevitably be a group of people who will take drugs with or without a ban. This is precisely the group of people opposition has characterized for us today because they are currently already hooked to and addicted on drugs in the status quo. So even if a legal market doesn't exist, the only alternative is for them to turn to an illegal one. Why exactly does opposition put the health of existing drug users at stake? This is because when drugs are banned, hold on a minute, madam, and shrouded in secrecy, drug users are shamed into concealing their identities because of the massive stigma attached with being labeled as a drug user. Yes.
And they assume this responsibility, but if they take drugs and we legalize them, we affect the whole population.
No, we don't affect the whole population, we benefit the whole population because when drug users themselves are now more likely to turn to safer state mechanisms rather than black market, which is precisely where gangs perpetuate crime, and violence, as well as gang violence, for instance, that's precisely where you benefit the whole of society. Back to my argument. What this means is that existing drug users are far more likely to coalesce with fellow drug users because there's a sense of identification and commonality. I can empathize with a fellow drug user because he understands the reason behind my lifestyle choice, as opposed to a state which infinitely wants to impose a restrictive ban on a lifestyle that I so want to embrace. Therefore, when opposition told us that the state is going to be perceived as harming drug users, this isn't the case. This perception is only fostered when the state is seen as an entity which is completely distanced from drug users and unable to understand their position. Therefore, the outside only forces drug users into an echo chamber, an insulated community where no one ever counterblows their opinions. This is damaging because they're likely to affirm each other's beliefs. Therefore, when interacting primarily with only fellow drug users, I'm more likely to convince another drug user into taking hard drugs. Even though we argue that drugs are a legitimate choice to make, nonetheless, we still want to nudge existing drug users into taking safer options, which might include softer drugs instead of harder ones. For instance, after President Philip Calderon initiated the war on drugs in Mexico in 2006, heroin consumption, which is a hard drug, increased threefold in subsequent years, so their policy is only ineffective. How is our side comparatively better? Because we eradicate the stigma of a ban, when people no longer have to go underground or hide at homes because for fear of being caught by the legal mechanism of the law, you now force more people to turn and embrace their lifestyle in broad daylight. They're no longer afraid of exposing their very own identities. This is excellent because now they can rely upon familial support for them to cope with, for instance, undergoing rehabilitation or treatment. But next, you also make them more likely to turn to rehabilitation because the state is no longer seen as an entity which actively opposes and undercuts the very lifestyle which drug users want to embrace. So on a psychological level, you make drug users far more receptive to state mechanisms and state support. But our last tier is this, that even if some drug users continue taking drugs, at least they're more incentivized and likely to take softer ones, which are less deleterious to their health than hard drugs, for instance. It's for this reason that we better protect existing drug users. That's why we're proud to say that abandoning the battle on drugs means winning the war on drugs.